When we look out into the star-dotted void of deep space, we see no obvious evidence of anyone else populating the galaxy along with us. There are a huge number of proposed solutions to the Fermi Paradox as a result. I know of well over 100, all varying in likelihood. But in the end, it may simply be that life in the universe is common, even intelligent life, but for some reason, we simply can't see it. We just assume that aliens might want to contact us, so we look for it. But maybe they don't wish to do that. So here are 10 reasons aliens may never contact Earth. Number 10. We're too warlike. It's no secret that we are a warlike species. Countless wars have been fought across most of the planet's continents, and warfare ranks as one of the oldest things humans do. It's also something we may eventually outgrow and cease, but we're a long way from that right now. We also tend to assume that at least some alien species somewhere out there will not be warlike, or will have long ceased practicing it. Warlike aliens take many forms in science fiction, from alien invasions of Earth, such as in Independence Day, to interstellar wars between species, often depicted in Star Trek. But aliens may not practice warfare at all and have nothing like it in their history. It's also possible that the circumstances of a species never promotes any kind of conflict, especially if an alien species maintains a small population by its nature. As a result, when they come across a warlike species in their exploration of the galaxy, they may adopt a no-contact protocol and do everything they can to hide their presence from the warlike species. This may even extend to artificially cloaking their planet's biosignatures in order to render their technosignatures undetectable, thereby creating a very unnatural situation where the Great Silence is explained by the notion that all advanced alien civilizations have technology so good that they can't be detected, even if they are present throughout the galaxy. Perhaps a natural end to this, however, is that once a species stops warfare and outgrows it, then contact may be established, and that the declaration of world peace on a planet is immediately followed by contact. If a species never gives up warfare, so long as they stay confined to their world and threaten no one else, then that species may spend its entire existence believing that they are alone. Number 9. We're not advanced enough. We are not the only tool-using species on Earth. Tool use among primates, birds, mammals such as elephants, and so on are well documented. But it actually goes even further than that, depending on how you define tool use. It's been noted in nature that even certain species of alligator and crocodile will recognize that birds use sticks to build nests, and in response actually balance sticks on their heads and trap the birds as they go for the sticks sitting on top of the alligator's head. This is rather amazing because it means that the alligator understands the seasonal behavior of the birds, but also understands the concept of a trap based on a lure. This research has been called into question recently, in that studies showed that alligators may not be intentionally doing this, but at the same time, they do seem to balance sticks on their heads. But what we don't do is try to communicate with these animals on an international diplomatic basis as though they were a nation-state entity. This may be how aliens see us. We're new to the high-technology game. Even just a century ago, we were not a space-faring species, rather merely fantasizing about one day doing it. A century is not a long time in the grand scheme of the universe. It may simply be that aliens aren't interested in us at this level of technological development. We might be noteworthy in the same way as the aforementioned alligator, but the alligator is going to need to do a lot more evolving before we let them open an embassy. We may be in the same boat, in that aliens may be so far advanced that we're just nothing close to even being able to comprehend them, in which case it may take us millions of more years to get to a point where aliens find us interesting enough to contact. Or they may become so advanced that they do things like create new universes of their own and leave this one, and we may never know they ever existed. Number 8. The Prime Directive. Perhaps a well-worn concept within science fiction is Star Trek's Prime Directive, where you do not interfere or intervene in a developing civilization for fear of influencing them negatively. whether through the introduction of technology too early or the cultural impacts that premature first contact could have. And those concerns are valid, if a bit cliche these days. If we'd have been given laser technology in the Middle Ages, for example, we'd have probably either never figured out how to use it, or the local ruler would have put it to military use and built an empire. At the same time, however, the argument could be made that certain technologies, such as medicine, if introduced into a primitive society, could transform it in a positive way. But that assumes that you care, and aliens may not. They may see no value whatsoever in interfering, even positively, with a developing civilization. We do not vaccinate ants, as an example. They may rather simply just watch or ignore developing civilizations, deeming it simply too much trouble to involve themselves in the affairs of a primitive, though technological, civilization. Or they may go the Star Trek route and very carefully conceal themselves to avoid any kind of cultural or technological interference, preferring instead to allow civilizations to develop on their own and take their course until they come into contact with that hidden alien civilization. But in this case, you'd need a very secure, very advanced alien civilization, because to allow that to happen, the civilization must assume superiority. When the lesser civilization comes into contact, you'd need to be absolutely certain you could defeat them handily and not get conquered yourselves. This is actually a rather scary scenario, where the galaxy is ruled by an invisible but absolutely all-powerful force that lies in wait for you to find it. Once you do, it then judges you, and you either survive or you do not. Number 7. Aliens never contact anyone. When thinking about alien first contact, we tend to assume that the aliens would want to do it. Two groups of technological aliens meeting and giving each other the Vulcan sign of peace is a common theme. But at the same time, it may be that first contact just isn't important to anyone except humans. We'd love to see it, but that may just be because we haven't yet met an alien species. Would it be the same after 452 first contacts? Meeting the first alien species would be amazing, but would number 600 evoke the same sense of wonder? Well, it's likely that it'll never get boring for specialists. Let's not mince words, I'd make a video on every single first contact here on this channel. But there are plenty of people on the planet that would yawn and move on without much thought about yet another alien civilization saying hello. So you have to wonder, are there indifferent alien civilizations that place no value on someone contacting them? And, in the same grain, never try to contact any other civilizations? And there's always the question of inherent xenophobia. Aliens may not want contact with anyone that isn't them. It's possible, but this type of civilization has the odd attachment that they may end up being among the most easily detected civilizations as far as technosignatures go. If they don't care about first contact and just ignore it when it's attempted, then they probably don't care much about hiding their presence. Indeed, for security reasons, ensuring their presence is known in order to scare away first contactors might be a priority. If you want to keep others off of your lawn, you need to put up a sign. More on that in a bit. Number 6. They don't know we're here. Earth presents a sort of dichotomy. On the one hand, our biosphere's strange disequilibrium of certain biology-related gases has been visible for a very, very long time, enough for any astronomer in the galaxy studying exoplanets to have picked up on and deduced that there was a biosphere here. It's the exact opposite in regards to our civilization. We have only just barely been detectable for a century, and even then, intermittently. Certain radar over the years has been detectable at a distance, but that's about it. To hear our radio stations would require an improbably enormous radio telescope, and even then, it would have to be within 100 or so light years to catch the propagation of our radio waves. That's only a tiny fraction of the galaxy. As a result, while aliens might know that there's a biosphere here, they very likely don't know that we're here. And it may simply be that we'll go a long time thinking about the Great Silence, until it suddenly stops being silent as alien civilizations find out about us and start trying to establish contact. First contact may not happen soon, but in a few thousand years, it may be routine. Number 5. Contact is futile. Or maybe it will never happen. Our radio signals are weak, and on some fronts are getting weaker. While we probably won't ever go radio silent, radar is too useful, It may be that we just don't produce signals strong enough for anyone to detect. Maybe aliens don't build radio telescopes the size of Chicago, and they forever simply can't hear us, or even know to contact us. And then there comes the possibility of actual direct encounters, and the problem there is worse. To actually meet an alien face to face, if it has one, is a tall order. We know of no way to do it without crossing vast amounts of space, and doing so over a vast amount of time. The universe seems to short-circuit every way we can think of to accomplish faster-than-light travel, and the few ways that seem viable, or at least don't violate any rules of nature that we know of, such as the Alcubierre Drive, require vast amounts of energy and present problems that may never be surmountable, such as whether you can survive in a warp bubble of this type. As a result, it may simply be that aliens are too distant. We can't realistically interact with them or even know they're out there, and it's the same for them. Thus, if we never make a detection of an alien civilization, we could never rule out that they're not out there, because of the great distances and energy involved with finding out. And it's the same for the aliens. Number 4, we're too different. Communication is something dependent on the assumption that whatever you're communicating with will understand you. One does not expect to meaningfully communicate a complex idea to a tree or a rock. Another human, a pet, and even a computer, however, can understand or partially understand your meaning, and thus we can communicate with them. But that may not necessarily be the case for an alien civilization. It may be that for them, communication is just that, raw information transfer. And the pleasantries of human speech and interaction are simply not present. They communicate only when they wish to transfer information, and thus may never contact us if they see no reason to do it. This could be for a variety of reasons, ranging from simply not being interested in talking, to an overall conclusion that communication with us won't work, either because there's no way we have to know when a signal will come through, and energy constraints placed on long-term broadcasts of contact signals leads the aliens to never try. And even if communications could be established, the alien civilization may conclude that we have no commonality with them. Thus, no conversation can be had because both sides are incomprehensible to each other. This would lead to one of the stranger solutions to the Fermi Paradox, that communication is just too hard, so no one ever does it over interstellar distances. Or it's not worth it because no one in the galaxy is likely to ever understand one another, even if they do attempt to communicate. Number 3, we are alone in our abilities to communicate. There are many ways to hypothetically communicate. We tend to use spoken or written language. And while we can watch animal communication occurring around us, only in rare instances do we know what they're communicating. We know that whales and dolphins seem to be saying something to each other, but what it is eludes us. On the other hand, we have successfully communicated with gorillas and chimpanzees, but only because we were able to teach them sign language. And there are other ways to communicate. Chemical communication is another option, as is tactile or touch communication. The question is, what method would an alien make use of? The answer is that verbal communications for it may not be in the cards, especially if the atmospheric makeup of the world differs significantly from our own. But if you communicate using touch only, for example, your paradigm on what communications are becomes completely different from a human, and that may alter how they view communications via SETI. Same with chemical communications. Transmitting chemical information by radio may seem completely alien, so to speak, and a fruitless thing to even attempt for an alien species of this nature. So in the end, the very idea of looking for radio signals from an alien civilization may have too many human biases built into the notion, and as such, it would be no wonder if we never hear from aliens, even if they are attempting to say hello. This idea alone may lead to no one ever trying to establish contact. Number 2, don't blow your planet's cover. While we have never made an unambiguous detection of an alien technosignature, we do have a handful of candidates. These include some well-known examples, such as the WOW signal and Tabby star, but there are more obscure ones, such as the star HD 139139, where it sees repeated dimming events that appear to be transiting Earth-like exoplanets. The problem is that during the initial 87-day observation period, there were 28 of them, and none of them appeared to be periodic. The star is a double star system, so it's unclear which member is producing the dips. Potential explanations for that star have included a very chaotic situation where the planets in the system are unstable, and we caught them while they were being tossed around. Also on the table is a disintegrating planet, an extremely dusty asteroid belt, and sunspots on one of the stars, and no explanation quite fits though. As a potential alien explanation, the interesting thing about the star is that we actually transit the sun from their perspective, which only about 0.5% of nearby stars in the galaxy have that ability. We are only barely visible, but visible we are, and if aliens were studying exoplanets, they could in principle know about Earth. That might lead them to construct a huge, unnatural visual display, such as an inexplicable transit pattern, in order to say hello. But there is another candidate, and it's rather spooky. In fact, it's one of the more spooky things I cover on this channel. I've made videos on this channel on this star, and indeed all other candidates, but this one deserves more attention because if it is alien, it wouldn't be sending a message to us, we're not a threat, but to someone else that is. It's Shabelsky's star, which contains large quantities of transuranic elements and weird decay products like technetium and other elements that really shouldn't be in a star. On the one hand, this star may be in some bizarre nuclear circumstance that's very rare, causing it to produce elements not normally present in nature, or it's the activities of an alien civilization. If it's the latter, there are a number of things it could be, such as making a star into a nuclear reactor that can produce transuranic elements, or it could be a warning to someone that the civilization in that system is so advanced and powerful it can alter a star and show that they have very advanced nuclear physics capabilities. In other words, they could be telling someone to stay away. And if that's the case, and the civilization went to that length to post a warning sign, then it would suggest that there's something highly malevolent and powerful lurking out there, presenting a threat. As a result, it may be that no civilizations broadcast messages out because it simply isn't safe until you are extremely advanced, or you're noticed and destroyed before you get to that level. Number 1. There's something about the universe we don't know. When it comes to understanding the universe, we have essentially two handicaps. The first is that our understanding of physics is incomplete. We know some, but not all. And no one yet knows what lies in the undiscovered areas of physics. Within that question lies another question. Is there something there that prevents or discourages alien communications? Are such things rendered dangerous in a multidimensional universe, such as that proposed by string theory? But the second is the most problematic preventer of communications. It's simulation theory and its implications. While the universe probably isn't a simulation, the possibility does remain. The question is it testable? There have been some hypothetical ways to test whether it's indeed a simulation, but no answer so far. That said, if we imagine that it is, and the result of that is that the entire universe is essentially not real, it may easily be that when a civilization reaches the simulation conclusion, then there really isn't any point to contacting other civilizations because, well, none of it is real. And communication ultimately serves no purpose because the question of other civilizations simply stops mattering. It's a bleak and somewhat terrifying possibility, but a possibility nonetheless. The question then becomes, can you communicate with whoever is running the simulation? Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently worried if we've got our cosmology wrong, and it really is turtles all the way down. In such a scenario, no one communicates across interstellar distances because whenever they try, all the turtles whisper hush, and the whole thing becomes awkward. Very disconcerting. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.